So in yesterday's class, we were looking at what the delay through an inverter is going to be like when it is charging a capacitive load, right? So the setup that we have is something like this. There is an inverter. There is a load capacitance, CL. What we said was the internal structure of the inverter looks something like this. There is a PMOS transistor. There is an NMOS transistor. There are parasitic capacitances due to the drain and source, right, which we'll mark as CDN, parasitic capacitance due to the PMOS and NMOS, right. The drain capacitances are the ones that matter because they are connected to the output terminal. The source capacitances have the same voltage on both sides, so there's no real impact in terms of the delay. Okay. All right. So this is the setup that we have. We have input over here, Vi, and the output Vo is what we are interested in. And what we saw was the equivalent circuit for this can essentially be considered as, depending on whether it's rising or falling, it would either be R equivalent of the PMOS feeding into this combination of the drain and load capacitances, or a falling transition where it would be this, but the capacitance would remain the same. So a couple of things to note over here. Remember how we did the estimation of R equivalent, right? We essentially said that we will sort of average out the V by I in the range V falling from VDD to VDD by 2. Okay? And that is essentially what we primarily consider as the equivalent resistance, right? So alternately, as far as the NMOS is concerned, what happens over there is that the voltage across it is actually going to be dropping from, again, it's going to be dropping from VDD to VDD by 2. In the case of the PMOS, initial, you know, that results in a rising voltage. Once again, the VDS across it is VDD, and that drops to VDD by 2 in the course of charging, okay? Which is why we took the average across the VDD to VDD by 2 range as far as the resistance is concerned and came up with the number 3 by 4 VDD by IDSAT, okay? The other thing is the CDP and CDN and CL is of course an external fixed constant. CDP and CDN are the same nominally, right? But hopefully you have already had a chance to look at the tutorial questions that I sent out. One of them involves more detailed computation of the drain diffusion capacitance, right? In particular, what it tells you over there is those capacitances are voltage dependent, right? So what happens when they are voltage dependent? Effectively what that means is you will see a different capacitance whether you are discharging from VDD to VDD by 2 or charging from 0 to VDD, right? The nature of the capacitance will actually be different in each of those cases, right? Or the value of the capacitance, right? But what we say is it is sufficiently close to some average value that we can just take the average and go with that number. And that's what we do, right? Why am I going on stressing on all of these things? Because you need to keep in mind that all of the things that we are doing here, the hand calculations, the approximations, if you try comparing them with the results you get against SPICE, you will see errors, right? The only question that we need to ask is, how acceptable are those errors and do they justify using these numbers for the purpose of hand calculation? Okay. All right. So now, let's look a little bit closer into this, right? So the first thing is with regard to R equivalent, right? The approximate equation that we have for that is 3 by 4 VDD by IDSAT, right? Whether it's P or N, I'm leaving that part out, okay? Now, VDD is a constant, but IDSAT is, among other things, the one thing that you as a designer have control over is the W and L, okay, in particular the W, the L is usually always kept constant at minimum length, right? So the one thing that we can see over here is ID sat is proportional to W, right? The greater the width of the transistor, the more current is going to flow. That is true whether it's NMOS or PMOS, right? It's only the constant of proportionality that changes, okay? So if that is the case, then the one thing that we can say is R equivalent is inversely proportional to W. Okay. The other thing that we can say is for the unit size or minimum size or the reference inverter is a better way of calling it. Wp is equal to 2wn. This was chosen by us, right? I explained the reasons for it the other day, right? One possible reason is that you would get the Vn close to VDD by 2. But the other main reason which we actually see over here is this will actually make the Rp equal to Rn or close enough, right? So Rp will become approximately equal to Rn. Under these conditions, Rp is approximately equal to Rn, right? In other words, the current that the PMOS can generate for a given set of voltages is half that of the NMOS, but I am making it twice as wide, so it will end up generating the same current, okay? So the Wp equal to 2Wn is primarily chosen for this reason, to make Rp equal to Rn. Okay. So one way that we can in fact write this is, if transistor is of size k, okay, what does that mean? This essentially means that W equals k times 2 lambda. Okay. No, sorry, let me rephrase that. It means something slightly different. It actually means that W is equal to K times Wn for NMOS or K times 4 lambda for PMOS. Okay, so what are we saying? When I say that an inverter is of size k, right? An inverter of size k essentially means that both the PMOS as well as the NMOS have been scaled up by a factor of k, okay? Which means that the NMOS is k times the width of the minimum size NMOS, PMOS is k times the width of whatever was used in the reference inverter. In other words, sorry, I really confused things over here. This should be k into 4 lambda for the NMOS and k into 8 lambda for the PMOS. In other words, k times whatever is used in the reference inverter. Okay? So a k-sized inverter essentially means that the width has been changed, the length is unchanged. Okay? And how much has it been changed by? Both of them have been scaled up by a factor of k. So both the PMOS as well as the NMOS are scaled up, keeping the ratio between them the same, 2:1. Okay? The ratio between them being 2:1 is important so that the rising and falling delays remain the same, are more or less equal. If I make the ratio between that, the PMOS and NMOS, not 2:1, then I'll find a significant difference between the rising and the falling propagation delays. Okay, I don't want that, I want to keep that equal, but subject to that I would like to be able to see what happens as I scale the inverter. So k sized inverter essentially means that NMOS is k times 4 lambda, PMOS is k times 8 lambda. Okay, what this means is we can even write the R equivalent is equal to R of the reference inverter what's the relationship between the R equivalent of a K sized inverter versus R of the reference inverter? R by K. Right? So in other words, if I make the PMOS K times wider or the NMOS K times wider, the resistance goes down by that factor K. Okay? So this is a useful piece of information. It's essentially telling us that, fine, I know how to analyze the minimum sized inverter. What changes when I change the size of the inverter away from minimum size into something larger? As long as I keep that ratio the same, the resistances just go down by that factor K that I used in order to scale the transistors. Okay? Why is this important? We'll see that very soon, because the main thing that you need to keep in mind is, even though we are doing the analysis to start with using minimum sized transistors, in general, when you are building circuits, you don't want to make the transistors minimum width. Minimum length is always guaranteed, right? Because making it more than minimum length is only reducing your current, it's not helping you. Okay? But minimum width may not always be helpful, primarily because it means it has a very small ability to drive current. It may not be able to drive large loads. So then comes the question, what happens if I want to make a bigger inverter, something that can drive a larger capacitance? Okay? So anyway, the important point is, if I scale the inverter by a factor of K, the resistances come down by this factor K. Okay? Now let's pay some attention to the capacitances. Okay? I'm going to look at the parasitic capacitances over here, CDP and CDN. Okay. Now, what can you say about those capacitances? Is there any relationship between CDP and CDN? What can you expect? So there are two parts to this question. One is there a relationship between CDP and CDN? The second is, if I scale the inverter by a factor of K, what happens to CDP and CDN? Right. So what are CDP and CDN? They are drain diffusion capacitances. If you look at the way the drain diffusion capacitances can be computed, they are sort of related to the doping concentrations and so on. But the primary thing that comes out finally is the fact that they are going to be proportional to the area of the drain region. Okay? Now, if you look at the layout of a transistor, essentially what it looks like is, this is the gate region, source and drain. These lengths are going to be fixed, right? This is the LS and the LD. They are just fixed by whatever layout you used, right? This W, on the other hand, is one of the parameters that you actually vary with as part of the design. Okay, which means that overall the area itself is going to be proportional to W. Okay, so the first thing that we can see is CDP would be equal to twice CDN. Okay? Not exactly equal, because there would be differences due to the doping concentrations. One is a p-type substrate, other is an n-type substrate. Okay? But a good approximation, you know, depending on the fact that the concentrations used are typically similar and so on, you can come up with this thing that it's going to be more or less equal. In practice, it is more or less equal. Okay? That constant of proportionality, which means basically that now the capacitance has just become proportional to the width itself. So CDP is equal to 2 CDN. Okay? If the entire thing is scaled, CDP will become K times the CDP of the reference. CDN will become K times CDN of the reference. Okay? So both of them, in other words, scale just based on the width that you use for the transistors. So this is again useful information. One much more useful piece of information is going to come up soon after this, okay? Because the next thing that we need to consider is, all so far we have considered the equivalent resistance of the transistors and the equivalent drain diffusion capacitance. Next thing we need to look at is, what is this inverter going to drive? It's going to drive another logic gate, typically, right? What is that other logic gate going to look like? It is also maybe going to look like an inverter. It will probably either an inverter or an AND gate or a XOR gate, whatever it is. In general, it will have a couple of transistors that that wire is connected to. One PMOS, one NMOS. Okay. So let's assume that this inverter is driving another inverter. Okay. What does the schematic look like? Over here we have the CDN and CDP as the parasitic capacitances of the first inverter, the driver stage, right? After that, we need to find out what is CL, the load capacitance, okay? And what is the primary contributor to load capacitance over here? The gate input capacitance of the two transistors, the PMOS and NMOS of the second inverter. Okay, so there will be some gate input capacitance corresponding to this point over here, CG of the NMOS. Similarly, there will be a gate input capacitance for this PMOS. Okay, now one thing you need to keep in mind, somebody had in fact asked this question yesterday, was what about the sort of gate to drain capacitance and so on, the other things. We are only considering gate to ground, drain to ground and so on, right? What about, for example, gate to drain capacitance? Yes, it is there. In fact, in the case of the inverter, it is not even something which can be easily ignored. For the time being, we are not going to consider it, right? Because most of our calculations, we can get reasonably good estimates even without considering that gate to drain capacitance. But keep in mind that in general it cannot be ignored. There can be situations where that gate to drain capacitance contribution can be significant. Okay, but for now we are ignoring that. Okay, but once we know this, that we are just interested in the gate capacitances, what can we say about those capacitances? What do we know about the relationship between CGN and CGP? What is CGN, for example? What's the formula that we know for CGN? Epsilon ox by T ox into Wn into Ln. Right? Epsilon A by D. Epsilon ox and T ox are just dependent on the oxide which is used, the gate oxide. The whatever, you know, 4 nanometer thick oxide that you have over there, right? And the epsilon itself is just dependent on the material that you have. So it does not depend on whether it's p-type or n-type, okay? Which means that CGP is equal to the same epsilon ox by T ox into Wp into Lp, which straight away tells us the other useful information, that CGP is going to be equal to twice CGN. And if I scale up by a factor of k, both will go up by that same factor k. Okay. Now, it turns out that the per micron capacitance, right, which is, what is the per micron capacitance? Per micron gate capacitance, for example, is epsilon ox T ox into L. Okay? only the W is left out. And I get a number which is a capacitance per micron of gate width. Okay. Why is this nice? Because all that it means is that I just need to multiply by the gate width in order to get the actual capacitance. Okay. A typical number for this is approximately 1.5 to 2 femtofarads per micron. How do we get this? Plug in the numbers, right? You can actually sort of see that right away over here. Approximately what we are saying is this is a calculation, epsilon ox by t ox into L, right? You put in the numbers, do the cancellation of the various things, convert into the correct units. What are the units I am interested in? Femtofarads per micron. If I say to do this calculation, what I actually get is 1000 or 1.5 into 10 power minus 9 farads per meter, okay, which can be written as 1.5 femtofarads per micron. Why do I write it in those units? Simply because it's more convenient, right? My gate widths are anyway expressed in microns and my capacitances are all typically in the femtofarads range. So multiplying them gives me this value, okay? So around 1.5 to 2 femtofarads per micron is the typical gate capacitance. If you look closely at it, you will see that the L and T ox also scale with technology, which means that this is not just for 180 nanometer. It would be more or less the same even at other technologies, provided that the gate thickness, gate oxide thickness and the length scale in the same proportionality. Okay. So this is a useful number. Of course, it breaks down when we go to much smaller technologies, but still roughly this ballpark figure is more or less okay. At least for our calculations, we will use it. Right? Sorry, can you please raise your hand? I can't see who's talking. No, femtofarads. Yeah, it's 1.5 into 10 power minus 9 farads per meter. Right? So 1.5 into 10 power minus 15 farads per micron. So that's 1.5 femtofarads per meter. Right? So keep that in mind. So this is a very important number to think about. Your capacitances for for the gates, logic gates, are going to be in the femtofarads range. Right, this just make sure you remember it somewhere at the back of your head. Why? Because if you do a calculation and you find that you are getting a picofarad capacitance for a gate, for a logic gate, you have done something wrong. That is way too big, okay, for the kind of technologies that we are talking about over here. Right, and in fact, as we shrink technologies, those capacitances get even smaller. Right, so keep that in mind. There are situations where we will actually encounter picofarad capacitances, right? That usually happens when we are trying to go off chip, trying to drive a wire which is running off the chip onto another chip, for example, right? Those are common cases where you end up with large capacitances, right? Picofarads, but even large is picofarads. Nanofarads are almost unthinkable at these scales, right? But keep that in mind, the numbers that you should see should be in the femtofarads range, otherwise you are probably doing something wrong with your calculations. Okay. Alright, so let's assume 1.5 femtofarads per micron is the gate capacitance. Okay. So what that effectively means is CGN is going to be equal to this 1.5 femtofarads per micron into WN. CGP is equal to the same 1.5 femtofarads per micron into WP. Okay. Now, what we saw earlier over here was the CDP and CDN can also be expressed in terms of some constant, some diffusion capacitance per micron, right, just by dividing out the W and then saying I'll multiply by the actual value of W in order to get that capacitance, get the true capacitance of the drain regions. Okay. CDP is some femtofarads per micron into WP. CDN is also equal to some femtofarads per micron into WM. Okay. Now it turns out that there is an interesting coincidence over here, which is that if you actually calculate the numbers, these are approximately the same. They need not be, right? There is nothing at all physically which requires them to be the same, right? It just so happens that by coincidence they are very close to each other. Okay, that helps us because in terms of hand calculations it makes our life even easier. But keep this in mind, this is not at all necessary. There is nothing technologically which requires this to be true, right? It's just a coincidence. If it was not true, then there would be one scaling factor extra which we need to consider in all the calculations that we will do later, right? But that's about it. It would just mean that there is a scaling factor that we need to take into account. Okay. Right now though, it makes our life easier primarily because it allows us to write everything in terms of some basic capacitance C. Okay. So I'm going to say C is the gate capacitance of min size NMOS, that is W is equal to 4 lambda. Okay, which means that I can now write out everything else in terms of that. What will it look like? Essentially what I am saying is I have one inverter driving another inverter . I have this drain capacitance has a value C, this drain capacitance has value 2C, right? It's twice that. This is C and this is 2C. Okay. Of course, if that constant of proportionality was not the same, then I could sort of just multiply it by some factor gamma over here, right? So for our process, this gamma is approximately equal to 1, which makes our diagrams and our analysis a little bit easier. It does not really change things qualitatively. Okay. All right. So with all of this in place, let's now write down what is the delay through that first inverter when it is subjected to a step input change at its input and it is driving another identical inverter at the output. Okay. So what is the delay going to be? The tau is going to be given by R into total load capacitance. Okay, which is basically, let's say that this is the NMOS R, I will call the resistance of the minimum sized NMOS. Okay, what is the total load cap? I'm considering, let's say, a falling transistor. In other words, the input is rising, the output of the first stage is falling, which means it is discharging through the NMOS. Okay, that's why I wrote the resistance of the NMOS. What is the load capacitance? It says 6C, right? All these capacitances are in parallel from that output terminal to ground, they add. Okay. So in other words, the delay is going to be R into 6C. Okay. This is true whether it is rising or falling, because it's the same R and the same capacitance. Okay. So R into 6C, this is a useful piece of information. What becomes more useful is when we consider, let's look at a slightly different situation where one inverter drives an inverter of size K. Right? So what is an inverter of size K? PMOS has been scaled up to K times 8 lambda as width. NMOS is K times 4 lambda as width. Okay. What are the capacitances going to be? The total drain capacitance is going to be contributed by the first inverter. How much will that be? 3C. The input capacitance of the next stage? K times 3C. What about the resistance? R remains unchanged. No, R by K for the second stage. For the first stage, what is the resistance? It's minimum size, right? So it remains at R. Okay? Keep in mind, there are two inverters. The second inverter is only a load. I'm not measuring the delay through the second inverter. I'm measuring delay only through the first inverter. Right? There will be some further delay before the signal arrives at the output of the second inverter. I cannot estimate that right now without knowing what its load is. So I am leaving that aside. Right now I am just using the second inverter as a load on the first inverter. Okay. So under these conditions, what is the delay going to be? Tau will be given by R into 3C plus 3KC. Or in general, what we can do is take out this constant 3RC into 1 plus K. Okay. Why do I write it this way? This 3RC is a technology constant. It is dependent on various parameters that are determined by the technology that you are using. The R and C do not depend on the widths of the transistor, so they are not design parameters. Okay, so this 3RC term can be taken out as some tau naught, and we call it a technology constant parameter. Okay, this becomes even more useful when we start going towards other kinds of gates, because we will again use the same tau naught, this 3RC as defined for the reference inverter. We will use that parameter in order to characterize the delays of all other kinds of gates, which is why this parameter is sort of useful to know. Okay. Now, a typical number that we have for this 3RC, right, we can sort of estimate from what we have, from everything that we have so far. How would we go about estimating that? What is the approximate value of R? Can we get an estimate on R? At least ballpark estimate. I want to know whether it's like 10 ohms or 1 mega ohm or what is it. How would we go about calculating that? Huh? 3 by 4 VDD by IDSAT. So now I want numbers. what is IDSAT? What would you suggest is a good value for IDSAT? Hundreds of microamps. Okay, good enough for now, right? So let's just take that as our estimate, that it is 100 microamps. Okay, it might be 150 microamps, it might be 200 microamps. I want to, like I said, get a ballpark estimate. Okay, so let's just go with 100 microamps for now. Okay, what does that mean? That essentially means 3 by 4 is 1.5, this is around 1.3. This approximately works out to 13 kilo ohms or so. Okay, 10 kilo ohms roughly. Okay, good enough estimate, right? What is the value of C? Epsilon ox by T ox into L into W of the minimum size NMOS, right? That is W is equal to 4 lambda. So in other words, we already saw that this was around 1.5 femtofarads per micron into 4 lambda is, yeah, so lambda is 90 nanometer, 4 lambda is 0.36 microns, right? Okay, so this works out to be approximately how much? 0.5 femtofarads. Okay, so RC is approximately equal to, get used to the units, that's another thing that you need to get familiarity with. When you take kilo ohms into femtofarads, picoseconds. Okay, so 0.5 into 10, so around 5 picoseconds. Okay, so what is this tau naught parameter that we are working with? It is 3RC is equal to 15 picoseconds. Okay, this is a rough estimate, it might even be off by a factor of 2. Doesn't matter. I mean, the point is that right now I've just got a ballpark estimate of where those numbers are going to be, and I know that the tau naught, the 3RC parameter, is going to be around 15 picoseconds, which means that for one minimum sized inverter driving another identical inverter, the propagation delay through it is going to be approximately 30 picoseconds, right? This 3RC into 1 plus 1. Okay, so again, that's another important number to keep in mind. These are the kinds of numbers you are going to see for delays, right? Typical gate delays on the order of several picoseconds, several tens of picoseconds. Okay, but this is for a minimum inverter driving another minimum capacitance. Typically the next stage would be a larger capacitance, the delays would be higher, right? And the capacitances would be higher, so the delays would be higher. You would end up with something, several hundred picoseconds is fine, it is acceptable, it is not uncommon. But nanoseconds is very unlikely. Okay, at least for the kinds of gates that we are talking about over here. Okay? Right. So, let's plug this into some other numbers, right? And sort of see what happens as we try to drive large capacitances. Okay, so what happens if I take the same setup and try to drive a large capacitance? I'll just say this is a unit inverter or reference inverter trying to drive a large capacitance CL. Okay, now in this case, how would I write down the delay? What is tau? If I want to write it in the same fashion as I was writing for inverter driving inverter, so effectively it is going to be R into 3C plus CL, right? But I would like to take out that 3RC as one common term because that's my tau naught, right, which I already computed and I have as a familiar number with me. So I can write it as tau naught into 1 plus CL by 3C. What is 3C? This is the gate cap of a minimum of the driving inverter. So this is a useful piece of information to have, right? R into, and I can write it as tau naught into 1 plus CL by 3C. Which one?
3C.
In this case, the 3C is the diffusion capacitance. It is the parasitic, right? So in other words, this 3C over here is this C plus this 2C. Yes. The reason I wrote gate capacitance is because they happen to be equal in this case, right? And in general, what we will do is we will normalize the load against the gate capacitance of the driving stage. So that was intentional. Writing gate capacitance over here is intentional, but I agree it can be a little confusing. For now, just leave it aside. We'll, like I said, so what happens if the gate capacitance and drain capacitance were not equal? We would have an extra parameter gamma, which is a scaling factor. Okay. Now, the reason I'm writing it in this way is because I sort of want to convey one specific way of thinking over here, right? This second term is effectively a measure of how large my load is compared to how large I am, assuming that I am the driving gate. How much bigger is it than me? Okay. And in terms of measuring that, of course, I could have written it in terms of the drain capacitances, but the gate capacitance is something which is very clear. It is just something directly proportional to W. There are like no voltage dependencies or anything else as far as that is concerned for the most part in the active region, right? So because of that, effectively what we are saying is we will measure whatever is the input capacitance seen by this stage, right? By what is the capacitance that I present to my previous stage versus what is the capacitance that I am seeing as a load. Take that ratio. Okay. This can be considered, one of the terms that is sometimes used for it is fan out. Okay. It is a measure of fan out. Fan out usually means I have a gate, how many gates is that gate driving? Okay. But in this case, I don't care how many gates it is driving, I care about how much capacitance it is driving. Okay. So this, in other words, is a measure of the fan out of the gate, right? And why is fan out important? Because effectively what I am saying is, I want to, if I am a large gate, that is I have large transistors, I can deliver more current. I will be able to drive a given capacitance more easily, right? But if I am a small gate, I will be able to deliver less current and therefore find it harder to drive the next stage. The delay will be more. Okay, so in that sense, sort of knowing how big is the fan out relative to myself is important, which is why we take the next stage capacitance is capacitance divided by myself capacitance and use that in this expression for delay. Okay, of course, if you look at the way I derived it from the equation, that 3C should refer to the drain capacitance. It turns out that because drain cap and gate cap are roughly equal over here, I'm just saying that the same thing holds for gate capacitance. In reality, what I'm actually interested in is the ratio of the gate capacitances, the gate cap of the next stage divided by gate cap of my own stage. Because that gives me a clear measure of how big the next stage is with respect to me. Now, both of those terms are going to be proportional to the W's that are used. So it eventually turns out that whether you use gate caps or drain caps, they will work out to the same equation, right? But in terms of understanding, it sort of makes sense in terms of what is the next stage cap divided by what is my cap, the cap that I present to the previous stage that is driving. Okay, so that's why I am writing the equation like this. So tau is tau naught into 1 plus CL by 3C. Okay, CL is the next stage capacitance, 3C is self capacitance. Okay. Now, let's consider a slightly different situation. Inverter, same load, but the inverter is now of size K. What is the delay through this? First of all, how would you write it? The most fundamental thing is, it is going to be the resistance of the inverter, which in this case is what? R by K into 3KC plus same CL. The CL doesn't have a K multiplying it. Okay. Now with this, take out 3RC as the constant. 1 plus CL by 3KC. Okay. This 3KC is once again self-capacitance. This is the load. Okay. So what does it mean? Same configuration, inverter driving a capacitance. When the inverter was made bigger, that meant that the delay came down. Right? But there are two parts to it. The delay corresponding to the external load capacitance came down, but there is also another component to the delay, which is my self delay. This first part over here, which does not change. Okay, so in other words, what it's telling you is, if I make the inverter larger, yes, it will be able to deliver more current into the next stage and therefore drive it faster. But the fact that you made it larger also means that its parasitic capacitances have now become larger, and a significant amount of current is going to driving those, and eventually you sort of end up wasting possibly a significant amount of current. Okay, and beyond a point, let's say that I want to sort of minimize delay, I find that beyond a point I simply cannot improve because my self delay becomes large. That is the limiting factor. Okay, so let's consider some specific examples over here. Alright, we'll stop here for now, and we'll continue with this in the next class. But before that, I also wanted to announce, I had sent out a set of tutorial questions on the Moodle. Hopefully all of you have seen them. Most probably on this Friday, we'll have a discussion session on those questions, right? Like I've sent in the email, we will not be working out answers to the questions in class, okay? You are expected to have already attempted them. You can either, already if you have already attempted them, well and good, otherwise you can do them during the class, but you are expected to do them on your own, possibly in discussion with others as well, right? But preferably try and do them on your own, right? The important point is, the TAs will be here to sort of help you with questions that you have, but they will not be directly sort of solving the final solutions and giving them to you as prepackaged answers, okay? If you have any doubts, any questions, anything about what has been covered so far, this would be a good time to cover it. The reason for having it now is, in another couple of weeks, we have the quiz. So this is partly as preparation for the quiz also, to sort of give you a flavor for the kind of questions that you are likely to see as well.